the first memory is the asilo. What do you call it? The children creche or something.
Oh, the creche, yeah.
Creche. And there was a soup. It was in wartime. A soup based on cabbage and rice. I never will forget. It was coming in a bowl like this for lunch, and every day the same. And I never will forget that as a child. But then my mother used to produce the most wonderful food. That's why I became a cook, because I want to have the food that my mother used to prepare when I was a student in Vietnam. And I remember that my mother used to cook for six children, and the thing that each one wanted. So she didn't cook only one thing, two or three things, so that each one could be satisfied. The entire thing, you know, in wartime, my mother used to make things that were incredible with nothing. She was producing wonderful food, and we were always very happy. So the food was really shared in the family. I remember that when I was a child, about 5 or 6, I was in charge, because we lived in a station. Papa was station master of the railway. And I was in charge to go downstairs in the office and see if the train would depart on time, and go upstairs, said yes, so she could put the pasta into boiling water, so that when Papa was coming up for lunch, the pasta was perfect. So, and when you grow with things like this, you know the importance of cooking pasta, to have a decent plate of pasta. But I was involved as a child also in gathering the rucola around the railway. There were plenty of wonderful wild rucola for the salad. Then later on, increasing in years, I was in charge of getting fruit that was the dessert. In Italy, dessert is always fruit, normal families, but normal food as well. And I managed to find out all the farmers around that they had the best peaches, best grapes. And I was going there when it was the time, ripe time, the peak time. And I was very proud to come home with a couple of kilos of some fruit for the, and everybody was, well done, well done. So the connection, food, and it was extremely important. And then I was sent also to shop. I remember one day I went to the butcher, and my mother wanted some meat, and I came home and opened the parcel. It was all in slices, and she wanted a piece. I said, I don't want this, go back. You can imagine, go to the butcher and say, my mother doesn't like this meat. And he didn't want to change, so please, please. So he changed it then, and then I came home, and that was the importance of buying the right stuff. But I remember also that I was diverting 5 lire or something like that for buying a little bit of surrogate chocolate. And it was Ferrero, that one that today does Ferrero Rocher. They were doing sort of blocks of this sort of chocolate based of hazelnut and cacao. And just a little slice for me. It was my little cut, mafia. You see, being many children, each one was taking care of the next one. Mm. And being the smallest for many years, until the next one came, I was the recipient of all this attention, or less attention. Because sometimes they will see me on the road and not wanting to have the responsibility of me as a child. I said, go home. The command was always, go home. So I said to myself, if somebody comes after me, I won't be the same. And in fact, I took quite care of the little one. And then when he died, it was tragedy. It was very bad. Anyway, forgotten. Or we say to forget. Became a passion, because everywhere I was, I had the liberty and the freedom to go into the woods and take something for supper. The first actually was going with a truffle hunter, because the area where we lived near Alessandria, near Asti, it was the area of truffles. And there was a friend of my father that had a little dog and was going truffle hunting. Now in Italy, it's seldom somebody would take you with him to go and pick a truffle, because you would find the source of it. In fact, they go middle in the night sometimes with the dog sniffling everywhere. And there I was taken by this chap, giving me a little truffle to bring home. And that was a fantastic thing. And then from truffle we came to mushrooms. And slowly, slowly, with a friend of my father, I learned about collecting safely about three types of mushrooms. Because if you start to pick mushrooms, you shouldn't take anything. And until you learn actually to pick safely one or two or three, that's fine. And then you're gone. Now I can pick 200 mushrooms easily. It began when I had the Neil Street restaurant, which initially I was the managing director of it. Then I bought it from my brother-in-law. And I said to myself, if the space next door come free, that I would like to import things from Italy, the best, for the restaurant and so on. And then came my ex-wife and said, well, that could become something very important. And so we started to go to Italy and find products, and we sold the products in the little shop. And then we started to produce food there and import the first food, which was, I remember the first one was olive oil. We went to Turin and I saw a wonderful bottle of olive oil in a window, and I went inside and said, who makes this oil? And they didn't want to tell me. But then I found out the label, and we approached the company in Liguria, and that was our first supplier. And that was the principle of getting sort of artisan to do the wonderful food that for us was serving as a fantastic food to sell. And for them, it was a very good collaboration. So we took every artisan, never so from commercial companies. And the idea was initially to have just a shop next door. But then my wife said, wait a minute, so we are doing a brand here, Carluccio's brand, and we could sell it to other people. And so it was sold to, later on, 200 different independent companies in Britain. They were taking part of the range and selling in their own shop. It was very, very rewarding for them and for us as well. And I remember at the time that the banks, they didn't answer to that. Although we could prove that it was a very good business, they were very reluctant. It was the beginning. It was 85 or something. And for quite some time, we went through difficulties. Because in the 1990, actually, yes, the Carluccio's was open, and only 98 the first real cafe was born. Philosophy for me was to have a restaurant that I would have liked to be customer of. You know, that one where you go, you are recognized, you sit, you have good food, in good ambiance, and good prices. And that was the philosophy. Mm. The other philosophy was to have personnel which is well instructed, well professional enough, not just to throw the plate on the table, but to be very gracious and so on, and friendly and smiling. And the combination of all those four items, they did what Carluccio is today. I believe that the most important thing was the treatment of the management. The management used to be big managers in big companies. They were funding our way of being familiar, a little bit awkward at the beginning. But then they accepted. They see that the business can be done also having a little bit of humanity. Shall I tell you one thing? I don't know whether a piece of paper is in the Times the other day, came out that Carluccio created a new class. I was flabbergasted. And this new class is apparently a mixture of people that they visit the Carluccios every day. That's very pleasurable. Pleasurable because you see that, and that was the intention, to have any sort of customers. And not just an elite or something like that, but it crystallized by itself. You have business people, you have the old writer with this sort of internet things, you have the mother that gives milk to the boy or girl, and the mothers, they talk together about all those problems. And it is really pleasurable to see that. And then when it was sold, I felt a bit sad, actually. You know, that some, almost as part of me, would have gone. And it's not just say that you have 10 million for that or something like that. Money is fine, but the thought, you know, that Carluccio was forever gone, that was a bit sad. All those years, about 20 years, I wrote also 15 books. And those books, they are real written and long handwritten. No computer. I hate computer, actually. And I like to see everything in front of me and then sort of with a pencil. And I don't know how I've done it because it was quite a lot of work. Every book takes about a couple of years, actually, to start to write it, the researches and all of that. And then photography and to make it ready. And I am glad that I have done all by myself. Obviously, the recipe then they were tested with some home economists. One of them being Rose Gray, that unfortunately died. The first book, in fact, she was my home economist. I like art. You see, in Vienna, I spent time with Kokoschka, with Max Ernst, with Hundertwasser. They were people that I met in Café Havelka, the Bohemian Café, and I was very much impressed by that. And I think that I fed a little bit pasta to them, because I was cooking and sometimes they were coming over to eat a plate of pasta. And that was a lovely thing to share and to do. But at the time, I was perhaps drawing. I was very good at drawing at school. But I didn't paint at the time. It came much later. But I didn't paint for the last 20 years, actually. All the paintings that you see here, they are 81, around 79 or whatever. And for a long time, funny, that's really a funny thing. They were all, my painting, all put away because my wife said that they didn't fit in the style of the flat. So I could never have them. Now finally I can exhibit all of them. This one, it's one day it was asked by the Royal Association of Oil Painters and if I would stay model for 4 hours for 20 painters to paint my face, and I could choose then the best. I carve sticks. This, you know, when I have a stick to carve, whittle, and I probably did about 300 or something, and any moment, any time, with a little knife, you put it in the corner, you take a sort of stick from the country, and I have a collection there. Mm. The biggest change is that the British, they're open to various cuisine of the world now, because various cuisine of the world, they came to London. And one thing, it came to my attention, that everybody thinks Elizabeth David has done wonderful things for Britain. Yes, she has done it, but for us, foreigner, not for the British food. Because in the time after the war, where she could, like Jane Grigson, I met both. Jane Grigson was for me the mother of England, a very nice person. Elizabeth David, she was a bit more serious, intellectual of food. And she popularized French, Greek, Italian, but no English food. And I was a bit disappointed by that, because I said, there we are, somebody that takes from abroad ideas, where you have very good food here in England, you have very good ingredients. Only that those ingredients, they never or seldom have been treated with attention and so on. We have most wonderful game, most wonderful fish, vegetables, and soft fruit, and all of that. And it's really fantastic. Other countries, they would dream to have something like that. And I remember that when I took over the Neil Street restaurant, the first 2 or 3 years, I couldn't turn it because I was a managing director, and there was already steak and kidney pie on the menu. And it was the best steak and kidney pie in London, made by a Spaniard. And it was really wonderful. People say, my goodness, you know, with the proper crust and so on, very nice. Other dishes of England that I like, obviously, the roast beef and the Yorkshire pudding, it's a wonderful thing. But I like bacon. I like a bacon roll, it's wonderful. When I am picking mushroom in the woods, sometimes there are the little kiosk for drivers or whatever, and to have a bacon roll and a cup of tea is just wonderful. Simple. Porridge. A nice porridge is good. It's I like the grain, the taste of the grain, of the wheat, practically, or whatever it is.
It's oats.
Oats, yes. Yeah, but it is of the family of the grain. Mm. And I like that, and I like the combination of that and the milk. It's very good. I like milk. One of my secret follies is to have a tube of condensed milk. Ah! It's wonderful. Food is the essence of life. I mean, without food, we couldn't exist. The Italians say also without sex, we couldn't exist. It's pretty obvious. You don't procreate, you don't have people to feed. And in fact, it was my guru of ideas, Pellegrino Artusi, an old chef in Italy that wrote one most wonderful book about all the regions. He was exactly saying that sex and food, they go hand in hand. Not just as a pleasure, but for the actually effect. And food, starting from when I was a child, always became something to be passionate about. So that when I went to Vienna, as I said, I started to cook and became self-taught. And it is extremely important to treat food with respect. With humbleness, but with respect. Not making it tarted up, this is, would be something bombastic, which has nothing to do with food, actually. The best thing to do is to give wonderful taste to a product that you buy, fresh, possibly in season, of best quality. Treat it quite... My motto of cuisine is MOF-MOF. M-O-F, M-O-F. Minimum of fuss, maximum of flavor. That's all.